So, a very good evening to all of you. We are still in the lockdown, not so lockdown phase in India. And we welcome you all from far and wide to our Unlock series from the Himalayan Institute of Cultural and Heritage Studies. And it gives me great pleasure in announcing our speaker for today, Dr. Aniket Alam, who is an associate professor with the International Institute of Information Technology in Hyderabad. And today he will be talking about family and reforms in colonial Western Himalayas. And it's so important to look into this fair as well, so that we truly understand change, continuity, and how the pressures of all these things that we have gone through in history have impacted lifestyles, family structures, and all of that. And of course, Dr. Aniket Alam is going to give us a whole lecture on that. And needless to say, Dr. Aniket Alam is a JNU. He did his PhD from JNU, and he has done a lot more. He's currently doing a project in Spiti with his team. And you could tell us more about it. So let's start.
All right. Thank you, Anjali. Sorry, Sonali, for inviting me to this. And it's actually after quite some time that I'm presenting on this topic. This was part of my PhD research, which happened in the 1990s. And I have written bits of what I'm going to talk about today, but only little bits. In my PhD and then later in my book. And this is something which I think is important. And I have for the last 4 years been thinking about the fact that there are myriad family forms which existed in what was the territory of British India. And those family forms are more or less forgotten now. They have basically been swept away through various forms of reforms. Typically, these reforms were carried out with the intention of fighting religious or cultural practices which were seen as barbaric or anti-women or pre-modern, medieval. And what we today have in India, both legally as well as a social moral norm, is a very unified understanding of what the family is. What that also leads to is that in large parts of the country, people are find it difficult to access their own family histories, where their emotional and social lives are organized. One of these things which has been seen, and in fact, I'm trying to find the appropriate word, which is correct as well as slightly diplomatic, in the Western Himalayas, is seen as this barbaric form of polyandry. Of course, everybody doesn't call it barbaric. They often call it curious, strange, and out of the ordinary, something which is almost like a museum piece existing in society. What I'll do is I had actually, I had initially tried to make a PowerPoint with various things in it, bells and whistles. I never got around to finalizing that PowerPoint, but it's still there. It's like a more like lecture notes, which I can present, which will help you, which will perhaps help anchor the discussion. So I might share that screen. In between, I might also use the whiteboard in case we need to understand the structure of the family. What I would like to do here is to first talk about how we come to know of the Himalayan family, the first notices, what is the structure that we find there, and what form, why was it reformed? What was reformed in that? Why was the need for reform seen to be so important? And what came out of that reform? We will have a small tangent into defining what the family is, because that is important. We often don't, we work with implicit definitions, which may not be very helpful. So this is how I'm going to structure it. So I might start off the PowerPoint now, Sonali, if...
of course, you just have to press on the tab share screen and it will...
Yeah. So is this there with everybody right now?
Can you put this on full screen mode?
Yes. Yeah. Is that okay?
Yes, that's perfect.
Fine. So this is what I'm going to speak on, family forms and reforms in colonial Western Himalayas. Let me first mark out these things. Family, we are going to talk about what it means. When I say forms, I'm talking of the structure, the function of the family, how do we define the family, the reforms that happened. What was the change in the form of the family that was being proposed and pushed through? And when I say colonial, of course, that's an easy thing. It's during the British period. And Western Himalayas, and we'll see that it's, I talk of Western Himalayas because that's where my work is. But when we look at, and I have seen secondary sources, a few primary sources, the form of family that I'm talking about actually stretches far and wide across much of the mountain systems of northern India, northern British India, but not just that, in other places too, and we'll talk about that. But here, since I'm drawing on sources from the Western Himalayas, we'll just talk of that. Now, let's start with what exactly is. Now, if you look at anthropological literature, it is typically based on definitions. Looking at the structure or the function. So a family is composed of the father and the mother and the children. Or a family is one which is patrilocal or matrilocal. A family is patrilineal or matrilineal. The function of it, how does it work? Is it a family which... So basically, the typologies of what goes for a definition is typically typologies of family. What are the different types of families? How are they structured, etc.? And in this, much of academic literature, anthropological literature, sociological literature has till recently given primacy to the father. And of course, sometimes to the mother, that they are seen as a unit. Now, often the definition says it doesn't matter. The father is actually not the most important. It's the mother and the child of the mother who forms the nucleus of the family. Anyhow, we are looking at 19th colonial Himalayas, Western Himalayas. So in that, the family definition that was relevant at that time was looking at the father as the primary figure. The family was patrilocal, which means the family was located where the patriarch of the family was. The family was patrilineal, which is that the lineage, the genealogy of the family moved through the father to the son. And it was patronymic. The family's identity, the name of the family was through the father, which was passed on to the son. Given all of this, it was what is called a patriarchal family, which means that the father or the husband was the source of all authority within the family. Of course, that could be mediated through various rituals where other family members had roles to play. But finally, it was the husband or the father, the patriarch, who was the source of all authority. And the thing about the family that we need to remember, I mean, what exactly is the... the idea of the family, and especially when we are looking at classical anthropological literature, at the idea of family in the 19th century, is that it is this social unit which gives local, legal and social sanction to the heir, to inheritance. to property, to access to property. And this is built almost throughout, I mean, without perhaps with only one exception through the 19th and 20, first half of the 20th century, on an understanding that there is a social, a sexual exclusivity to women, that the woman has only one sexual partner who is then the father of the legal heir who inherits that property. And if that social sexual exclusivity is confused or in any way sort of broken, then there is a problem with identifying the heir, with identifying the inheritance, with control over property. It leads to disputes, it leads to other problems. And basically a family is broken where the sexual exclusivity of the woman to the father is broken. So the father can have more than one woman, but the woman has to have only one husband. The child has to have only one father. Now, in this sense, the family is both about the reproduction of life, of course, the biological reproduction of life, not just the birth of the children, but also the nurturing of the children to adulthood. But it's also about the production of assets, wealth, income, property, which sustain life. So it is as much about the biological reproduction as it is about the inheritance, the heir, the inheritance, which is the production which sustains life. Now, if you look at the family ideals of 19th and 20th century, monogamy, of course, is, and when I say monogamy, it is, of course, based on the patrilocal, patrilineal, patronymic, patriarchal family, where the woman and the children live in the husband's home, the woman and children takes the husband's name, the woman and children are known, the identity, the lineage is through the husband, and of course, authority follows there. And this built this whole morality of the family, the emotional unit of the family that we are known for, I mean, that the family is known for. So there is this father figure. The father figure is the central unit, and the family as there is then defined. So you have one father who, or rather husband who might marry one female or might marry female two and might marry female three to beget the heir again being a male, who then becomes the property holder, who then continues this process through monogamy. And the ideals of the family that were established in 19th century, and it is not just Britain, but in India, there is a certain uniformity in this, is that the family, the this link between the property holder and the producer of the heir is a lifelong union. It is not just a lifelong union, it is a lifelong union which is sealed through religious fiat, which is, it is that union is a sacrament, it is a divine ordination. And the family then, because it is a lifelong union, it is a sacrament, there is sexual exclusivity, it becomes the site for purest morality. So emotions then come to define the family, which is love, possession, possessiveness, which is seen not in a negative sense, but in a positive sense that, you know, you do anything for your family. The family becomes bigger than any other relation, right? The entitlements, the duties that engage with that. And in a sense, the reproductive and the productive, the economic, the biological, the social aspects of the family recede to the background, and these emotions come to define the family. That love, possessiveness, entitlements on which you can draw on your mother, on your father, on your husband, on your wife, on your siblings, on your children, these entitlements, the duties that you have to do, irrespective of the costs that they entail, these then come to define the family. And we look at it that, you know, while that is true, there is also this whole thing of how behind that there is a very transactional understanding of family, and we'll come to that. Now, family in the Himalayas. In the Himalayas, the first time we read about the family form is from the earliest European travelers. So it is in the region that we are looking at, the Western Himalayas, it is in the 1820s, that is exactly about 200 years earlier, that we see the first descriptions of the family. And these are from Europeans who are visiting the mountains for the first time. It is a journey of discovery. They are discovering not just new forms, social forms, they are discovering a climate which is very different and which reminds them of Northern Europe again. And the first thing that all these European officials and travelers and military men notice about the family in the mountains is the existence of polyandry, which basically means that a woman has more than one husband. And this is the biggest striking feature that you find everywhere. Now, I would like to read out, something from from a note that Captain C.P. Kennedy, who was the first person to actually set up a permanent residence in what now is the town of Shimla, wrote in 1824. In fact, almost to the date, 6th July 1824. He says, just a second. Marriage may be considered a species of slave trade. No man gets a wife without paying her father a certain price. If she's turned off without a cause assigned, the purchase money is retained. The women of the hills, until the British influence took place, the only species of marriage known in the hills from time immemorial has been, as stated, the fact that a woman is up for bargain and sale and may have as many husbands as they can afford, or she may, now this has become slightly unclear, but she may, I don't know, fancy, the word is unclear here. This is a photocopy of a record from the archives. I'll read out something else from Captain Skinner, who wrote a book where he traveled in the Himalayas called Excursions in the Himalayas, Captain Thomas Skinner, and this was published in 1832. This is based on travels in the 1820s, and he writes, and this is, he's giving almost a verbatim description of, he visits this village in what, from what he writes can make out, is today's Garhwal, bordering the Shimla district of Himachal Pradesh. He says, "I was the first sahib in the village. I asked a pretty woman of about 18 years of age, how many husbands she had? She replied, only four. And I asked, all alive? And she retorted, why not? The eldest brother, he goes on, the eldest brother is the father, within quotes, par excellence of each family. And on his death, that office devolves to the next. 100 years later, H.W. Emerson, who was the superintendent of the Shimla Hill States, he writes, the Himalayan family as such has been well described as a community of wives among brothers who have a community of other goods. And he then goes on to define it as fraternal polyandry. We'll come back to Emerson and what he writes about it later in life, later in this talk. But there is this compendium. It is called the Customary Law of Kangra District. It is part of the revised settlement 100 years ago. And if you look here, the same thing that comes up, that a woman is allowed more than one husband. A woman is allowed to marry, is allowed to divorce. A woman is allowed to remarry during the life of her husband. And there are various laws about, and so they are talking about how inheritance happens, how people, who gets what inheritance, which child gets what inheritance, etc., etc. Let me get back to my PowerPoint. So I talked about these examples from Kennedy and Thomas Skinner and Emerson. The other thing that came up in these examples I talked about is bride price. And this was again something which really shocked the Europeans who first came and recorded the family form here, was bride price. So what bride price is exactly the opposite of dowry. In dowry, the bride's family pays money to the groom, groom's family, for the wedding, for them to accept the bride. Bride price is exactly the mirror of that, where the groom's family pays money to the bride's family for getting the bride. Now this bride price is, as anthropological literature tells us, is extensive all over the world. It is not something which is in the Western Himalayas. In fact, if anything, bride price perhaps has far greater prevalence all over the world across social formations, whether they are pastoralists, whether they are settled agriculture, whether they are big states, whether they are small proto-states, etc., etc. Every sort of religion, every sort of social relation, bride price, often, in fact, in anthropological literature, comes up as one of the most common forms in which families are formed, marriages are organized. Basically, in the Himalayas, and this is common throughout, in fact, Emerson talks about how, from the Bible, gives examples about how bride price is commonly referred to in the Bible, and he gives examples in the Himalayas to say that the payment could be money, the payment could be assets, the payment could even be labor to gain a wife. So sometimes the husband would go and labor in the wife's family for a year or two. There's one case, Emerson, who was the superintendent of the Shimla Hill States, talks about that somebody labored for 7 years to pay the bride price for the bride. And when I say labored 7 years, we'll come to that, because what type of family it was. Because it's only one of the brothers who went, the other brothers don't. there also would be some money given, but this is basically, we're talking of a society where commodification is less, monetization is less, there are very few, very little currency in circulation. So often it is assets. So people would give animals from their pastoral herds, they'll give shawls, they'll give clothes, they'll give other assets of life, as well as money, to gain a wife. And these were basically things which were settled. You couldn't sort of bargain beyond a point, a little bit here and there, but typically the bride price was settled. What is the age of the wife, how much work she can do, etc., would define what the bride price is. And the other thing after polyandry and bride price that really struck the European travelers and officials who came to the mountains and noted about this is the fact that divorce was extremely easy and remarriage was common. And instance after instance, not only in travelogues, but in land settlement reports, in gazetteers, especially in land settlement reports, there is a lot of talk, lot of description of how easy it is for women to divorce and to move on. And what is talked about here in the Himalayan marriage and family is that the marriage is not a sacred rite. It is not a religious rite which cannot be dissolved, like it was in the Dayabhaga or Mitakshara family codes of the Hindus in the plains, like it was among the Christians. And even though there was divorce in the 19th century possible among Protestants, it was extremely rare, and it was assumed that marriage is lifelong, and it is. And in any case, that marriage happens in a church, it happens in front of the sacred fire. So the women could walk out of a marriage very easily and go and remarry somebody else was seen as really, really shocking. And what they realized was, when this happens, when a woman walks out of a marriage and remarries somebody else or goes back to her parents' house, the only thing that her ex-husband or ex-husbands can ask for is the bride price they had given. And sometimes, as the land settlements and other records tell us, that the bride price, along with the bride price, they would be asked to pay, the bride's family or the next husband would be asked to pay a dand, that is a fine. And that would be maybe a rupee, maybe 2 rupees. It was a nominal dand, but there was this fine that they would have to pay. And basically these three things, polyandry, bride price, and lack of chastity, was something which really shocked the Europeans who were coming from a perspective of 19th century Protestant morality. And in this, the lack of sexual exclusivity of the wife to a single man stood out in their eyes. All of these were very much part of that. And yet, they always looked at the family as a functional unit which produces heirs. So there is an inordinate amount of time and energy spent understanding succession laws, understanding how who is a bastard and who is not a bastard. And there are books where there's a whole chapter which is called Bastardy. And I mean, it's basically about how if I can just... So I don't know how clear it is, but if you see, there's a whole chapter here which says in this book, which is the customary law of Kangra district from the settlement, the Kangra's land settlement of 1914 to 1918, there's a whole chapter which looks at what is called bastardy, which is basically who is a legal heir and who is not. And It's an inordinate amount of obsession with trying to find what is happening there. So what is this stereotype of the Himalayan family that comes up. There's polyandry, there's bride price, there's lack of chastity, there's easy divorce. All of this equals, in the eyes of the Europeans and increasingly from the late 19th century, Indians who were coming up from the plains, whether it was Punjabi or Bengali or from the United Provinces or from the Bombay Presidency or from the Madras Presidency, people who were officials, they were coming as managers of the hill states, they were coming as settlement officers, they were coming as various other officials. For all of them, a combination of these four, polyandry, bride price, lack of chastity, and easy divorce, equaled barbarians. Now, of course, you could take your pick. Some of them thought the people in the Himalayas were noble savages, noble barbarians. They are great people. They are pure of heart, innocent, without any wiles, etc., etc. Others thought, well, not so much. But those were, in a sense, secondary. The point is that they were barbarians. They were not civilized enough. And if you look at the literature which is emerging from officialdom, which is settlements, which is gazetteers, which is various other forms of legal codes, customary laws, you would find that this form of the family is extensively noted all across the Western Himalayas, so much so that a gentleman who went and got, who became a barrister in London from Kumaon, Mr. L.B. Joshi, he came and wrote a book called Tribal People of the Himalayas, A Study of the Khash, which is basically about customary law and how this form of family works, how does inheritance work? How does the family work? Who owes whom what, etc., etc. But what is really, really interesting, and I would like to take 2-3 minutes to talk about that, is that it is also evident that this form of family is in existence outside of the mountainous regions. In other parts of the Punjab province, in Rajputana, in central provinces, in United Provinces, in the Northwest Frontier Province, in the Carnatic, even in Sri Lanka, in the Kandy personal law, you find all of these. And when I say polyandry, one of the things which perhaps I have not spoken about enough and clarified enough is that what the British looked at as polyandry was basically group marriage. And I'll come to that in the next slide, but here I want to just read out again from this book. This is a classic by Malcolm Darling, who was a British ICS officer who spent a lot of time in the Punjab, in the plains of Punjab. And he wrote a book which originally was called The Punjab Peasant in Prosperity and Debt. I think that was the name of the book originally, as it was called, The Punjab Peasant in Prosperity and Debt. However, the reprint has this name. This was published in 1928, and it is based on his experiences in Punjab, in the plains of Punjab, through the 1910s and the 1920s. And for example, he has, I'm reading out from page 52. Quickly, I'll just read out randomly because this is a long, long parts. He says, the second object upon which large sums of money are spent in Firozpur, Ludhiana, Jalandhar, and various other parts of the Doab throughout the central Punjab is the purchase. The fact is sometimes denied in towns, but is familiar to all those who live in these areas. And is familiar to, and not only north of the Jhelum, it can be said to be rare. Let me just skip a bit and come. So he says, in a country where the village woman is regarded as little better than a chattel, the purchase of brides is inevitable, though few perhaps would go so far as the frontier Pathan, who, finding that it would cost him rupees 30 to replace his wife's broken nose, seriously considered whether it would not be a better investment to get a new wife for rupees 80. And then he says, he quotes the gazetteer of Ludhiana to say, the custom is, that is purchase of brides, is almost universal and only a few of the better families abstain from it. A large number of lawsuits, civil and criminal, practically turn on the question whether the mother or the uncle or the fatherless girl is entitled to profits of, then he talks about their price. He says, as with everything else, this is very interesting. He says, as with everything else that is subject to the law of supply and demand, the price of brides has steadily risen. In 1922, a Gujar of the Murray Hills remarked to the writer, two wives I have wed and one has died. Both I bought 8 or 10 years ago for 100 rupees, but now if I would take a third, 3 or 4 times the price I must pay. And then he paused and added reflectively, cloth too is dear, but it has not risen more than the price of a bride. In the 1850s, a bride would be had for rupees 50, but nowadays in the plains, nothing worth can be got for less than 300-400 rupees, and a serious epidemic may considerably raise the price. In Rohtak, now of course that was also part of Punjab province, he says, for instance, where in 1918, the influenza epidemic carried off 10% of the people, the price rose from 500 to 2000. And then, most interestingly, he goes on to talk about polyandry. He says, as a result of the high price of brides, many never marry at all. In a Sikh village in Kasur, it is said to be 15 years since a boy was married. The people are too poor to buy brides and too notorious as burglars. Well, yeah, he goes on into something about how them being burglars and lazy and everything that. But interestingly, unable to wed the Manjha Jat, too often companies with the daughter of menials and elsewhere, polyandry is not unknown. For two or three brothers will sometimes share a wife, or a man will emigrate and hand over his wife to a brother till he returns. It is but a step from buying a wife to selling her. There are, Darling, one of the most important British civilians, writing on the Punjab province exactly 100 years ago, when they were facing a similar pandemic, without Zoom, of course, the influenza pandemic of 1918. So, what is exactly the structure of the Himalayan family? So there is the first typo that I have. What I mean is, monogamy was not the central point. The idea, the structure of the family, the Himalayan family, like all other families, if you go back to think about what I spoke in the beginning, the idea of the family was to create the best possible conditions for the sustenance of human life, both the reproduction and the production of life. So you need a reasonably large number of people living together, given that how dispersed habitations were, and continue, in fact, even today, despite all the achievements of hydrocarbon-laden development, habitations are fairly spread out, and earlier they were far more so. So you needed a reasonably large number of people in a unit of family who can engage in a variety of productive tasks parallel to each other, like farming, like pastoralism, foraging and gathering in the forests, yarning and weaving clothes, childcare, a whole bunch of others. This is just like on the top of my head, I was listing things that a typical family would have to do. And you would want a family form, a structure, which would block division of productive assets. So over generations, you don't have the sons dividing the assets. So in some parts of the Himalayas, you have the family property going only to the eldest son, the younger son joining the monastery or, you know, being sort of relegated to a really small part of the land, or maybe being forced almost to emigrate to find other places where they can set up a homestead. If you look at the Himalayas, what basically was happening here was that a set of brothers would marry together. As Emerson said, it is a commonality of wives and husbands. They are husbands and wives in common. So if you have a set of brothers, they would marry together and marry one woman at a time. Let me quickly draw this thing out on the board here. So typically what would happen, is this visible? Yeah, I think so. Just let me know if it is not visible. So typically what would happen, these are typically the symbols for men. So you have, say, a family of three brothers. They have inherited the property from their fathers, and they will marry one wife. They have paid bride price, which could be, I mean, it could be various things. It could be goats, it could be cattle, it could be shawls, it could be money, but let us just say 200 rupees as a thing. And then after some years, there is more work to be done. This family has stabilized. They have maybe got broken new land. Maybe one of the brothers has gone off to do trade and is not available there. One of the brothers may be giving begad far away from the family homestead. So you could have then these brothers. So let us say this is 1900. So a few years later, you might have a situation where these brothers go and marry, get another bride. This is 1910 we have reached. So you find if a person comes and looks here, they'll say, oh, this is polyandry. Then you come here and then it is a little horribly unchaste, barbaric. There are these two women, three men, all living together. And then, of course, this thing continues. Now you have, instead of only one person helping in agriculture, in weaving, in looking after the cattle, in child rearing, now you have two people to do family labor. You have still one husband here. Maybe one husband has come back. So and there is some bit of prosperity. This guy has come back from trade. Maybe the begad has stopped. He got paid for something for the begad. There is more prosperity. You can perhaps pay now because they also had to pay 200 rupees here. This perhaps 1920. And this time there is a land settlement happening, and this person comes and says, oh, this is a perfect family. This is a monogamous family. There is no polyandry here. It's the same family which has been going on. But the person comes and sees, okay, three brothers, three wives living in harmony. They were living in harmony here too. But this was, oh my God, this is polyandry. This, there's not even a word for it. And then here you have a normal, what is called a normal marriage. And then perhaps 1920, maybe there was influenza, right? And one of the brothers isn't there anymore. Lo and behold, you have a polygamous family. A polygamous family. And especially if another of the husbands has died, and maybe even another wife has died, then now you have a polygamous family. And the British or the Indian official who comes and looks and says, oh, there is polygamy here. In the mountains, there's polygamy. Whereas the same family had polyandry. It had something indescribable, which nobody has words for. They call it unchaste, you know, loose morals, etc., etc. They use all these metaphors from the Bible. They use metaphors from the market about vice being sold, and there's no concern about, and they're being barbaric. And then you have a normal marriage. This is, according to them, perfect, right? This is how the norm of the marriage is. And then, of course, you have something like polygamy. And of course, then you have polygamy. This is all fine. This is how marriage should be. It's the same family. And this is something that the let me get back to my perch. This is something that the British really did not understand. And this is what is crucial to understanding what was the Himalayan family. We need to remember that within this, it is not that women were equal to men, but their role was not confined to providing heirs to male property, which was basically what the conception of wives were in the moral and legal mentality of the British officials and the Indian officials, the officials of British rule, whether British or Indian, who were coming to the mountains. In the mountains, the wife, the woman in the family, was as much a part of sustaining the household economy as anybody else. In fact, much of the work much of the work that has happened on mountain economies tells us that women have a huge role to play in agriculture, in pastoralism, in weaving, in animal care, in a whole range of things. So, bring it all together. Brothers held property in common and passed it on in common. Husbands and wives were in common. Children had common fathers. Anthropologists call this form group marriage, but typically you don't hear most anthropologists who have studied the mountains talk about this. They talk about polyandry, the existence of polyandry, and then they'll go and look at the same family and say, oh, well, in this village we found no polyandry, only polygamy. Or in this village we only found monogamy. Whereas the family is about husbands and wives being in common. Within those husbands and wives, there was no sexual exclusivity. The sexual exclusivity was within that family unit. It wasn't one-to-one. And most importantly, the wives could walk out of it, go to another family, start another family with somebody else. If we look at the family, if we define the family different from what has been defined as an emotional unit of people whose social functions are aligned to create a sufficient economic unit which sustains itself biologically, socially, and emotionally, then we realize that the Himalayan family is as much a family as normal a family as anything else. is just organized differently. Maybe it developed differently to meet the conditions of the mountains, etc., etc. Anyhow, we will not spend too much of time on that. Let me move on to what happened under colonial conditions. And in some of the quotations I have done from Darling and earlier from Emerson and others, it is clear that the officials of colonialism were looking at the family as everything else through the lens of the market. Everything has a price. So there was commodification of land, of labor, of agricultural produce. It was not just in the mind of these officials. It got reflected in actual practices. So a land market emerged, a labor market emerged, a market of agricultural produce emerged, and the Himalayan peasants started participating in this market. Somewhere slightly better, somewhere slightly worse, but that happened. The market emerged, the market economy emerged, everything started getting a price. And from the late 19th century, we start seeing division of landed property. And this is exactly the time when you start having division of landed property, the brothers start dividing among each other, that you see a market for women emerge. And here, basically, bride price was used, the form of bride price was used to purchase women from husbands and fathers. So people would come up from the plains, whether it was government officials, Indian government officials mostly. Often there were traders, often there were various other people who had come only for human trafficking. They would come, they would talk, they would identify women, they would tell them, we'll give you a great life, you don't have to work in the fields, it's not as cold as it is here, we'll take great care of you, you come with us. Sometimes they would negotiate with the husbands and fathers that, okay, you paid a bride price of 200 or you paid a bride price of 400, we'll give you 1,000, we'll give you 700. And human trafficking, a system of human trafficking started. And this was already seen as a malaise. And this bride price, something I should have mentioned earlier, this bride price used to be called reeth. So when the bride price was paid by the ex-husbands or the guardians, if a woman left at divorce, it was called reeth. And that reeth included the original bride price plus a dund, which was the fine. By the 19th century, this was recognized, and the first state to impose a tax on reeth to try and curtail remarriage, to curtail bride price, to curtail the movement of women outside the mountains into the plains was Sirmaur, which put a tax on reeth. 10% of money was taken as tax. That, of course, didn't stop this thing. And what happened in the 1920s was that the first organized attempts to reform the Himalayan family and marriage form emerged. This was primarily through the organization which was called the Himalaya Vidya Parbandhini Sabha, led by a lot of young men from these areas. So from Bushehr, from Jubbal, from Sirmaur, from Suket, all these areas in the Himalayas around in the Shimla Hill States, they had studied in Lahore, some of them had studied in Delhi, and they came back, some of them were graduates, some of them had done law and they were practicing lawyers, wakil as they were called themselves, and they came back with the sense that this is something which needs to be stopped, both because it is barbaric and also it was leading to the growth of trafficking in women. So the campaign was basically to do two things. One was to stop the practice of bride price, saying that we are Hindus. Hindus do not pay bride price. This custom of marriage in the mountains is actually a distortion of Hindu law. So what we should do is change to Kanyadan, from bride price, from reeth to Kanyadan, where the daughter is gifted or given to the groom, and the money has to be paid to the groom, if at all. And secondly, to make divorce far more difficult than it was. As of that time in the 1920s, divorce was the easiest. Women could just walk out of a marriage because the marriage was not a sacred right. It was not a sacrament. They could just walk out of a marriage. This whole campaign was linked to the assertion of the emerging Rajput Hindu identity in the mountains. So a range of if you look at 19th century records, the cultivators, the peasantry in the mountains are called Khash Kanet. And that is throughout from well into beyond what is today Himachal, west of Himachal, right into western Nepal. They are called the Khash Kanets. And in the it starts in the late 19th century, but in the 20th century, you have a very strong, in the 1920s, 1910s, 1920s, 1930s, we have a very strong assertion of the fact that we are not Kanets, we might be Khash, and they would even not use that name very much. They would foreground the Rajput identity and the Hindu Orthodox linkage of the Rajput identity, and that got linked with the fact that this form of family, this form of marriage is something which Rajputs do not do. We need to change this form of marriage. It was also linked to civilizational progress. The Himalaya Vidya Parbandhini Sabha campaigned extensively on this, wrote to the governor of Punjab, it wrote to the British House of Commons, it wrote to the Legislative Assembly of the Punjab province, it wrote to various national leaders, it wrote to the press. I'll give you some examples of that. I'll talk about where all that happened. And one of the things they were foregrounding is that this reform of the Himalayan family is essential for civilizational progress. That in the mountains, the British have abolished sati, they have abolished female infanticide, they have abolished slavery, they have established women's education, they have done so much for social reform. This is something they have not done, and this is something which needs to be done. And it was seen as something which is crucial to the civilizational progress of people in the mountains, of making the people of the Himalayas norm. The same norm, you know, so which is why I sort of highlighted that word norm. The norm that we are not abnormal. Our social practices, our family structure, our women's honor and chastity is not abnormal. It is normal to what Indians, Hindus in the 20th century were visualizing for themselves, both socially, culturally, also legally. So it got a whole bunch of support from British officials, from nationalist opinion, Hindu Mahasabha. New rules were framed in 1926. On the basis of this, there was opposition. And over the 20th century, the old forms of family that I spoke about died out and were replaced by what is the normal family, which is the monogamous family with the father, the husband, as the center of the family. Now, what I would like to do is Sonali, can I take another 10 minutes?
You can take 20. We are really enjoying this.
Yeah.
Oh, great. So, yeah. So, what I'd like to actually do is, there's, this is a old thing from the 1990s. So, these are all archival documents, which I photocopied. Some of them are in terrible shape. So, I've been sitting over the last week and, marking out a whole bunch of things, which I think are really, really interesting, which I can share with you, which gives you a glimpse about what was happening in the mountains. How were people reacting to this? So, for example, the first thing I would like to read out is is a letter which was sent by the manager of Bagal State, headquartered in Arki in Himachal, dated 29 July 1924 to the superintendent of the Shimla Hill States. And he talks about the condition of women, and he basically says that, you know, he basically reproduces much of what so he says, so he calls it, so he says, cases of sexual intercourse with consent, and he underlines consent, are not scarce when one of the parties is immature, like it is common here. They, which is meaning the people of Bagal State, have lost the seriousness with which they should evoke among the people, owing to a general fall in the standards of morality. And in many cases, court aid is not even sought for punishment by the of the culprit. Abduction, enticement are so common that domestic life seems to have lost its security altogether. In many instances, children are deserted along with their husbands and house by fleeing women, and the poor father can neither look to his field nor to his children. Instances are common in which a lawfully married woman deserts her husband for a smarter man and definitely refuses to come back, and frankly offers to the husband her own price, the bride price. In almost all cases, the distressed husband agrees. There are more things. He goes on to say, So he basically goes on to say that he's writing on 26th July, 29th July, 1924. And he says, he proposes that no reith contract shall be held lawful after 17th September, which is basically first Asoj 1981 by the Vikram Samvat, that is 17th September 1924, after which date all persons, men and women, living with each other as husband and wife without performing marriage or lawful rites will be held to be breaking the law of the state and shall be punished for it. And he goes on saying all these various other things that need to be put in to make this marriage stop, this form of marriage. Then Thakur Surat Singh, who is the General Secretary of the Himalaya Vidya Parbandhani Sabha, on 4th September 1924, he writes to the Superintendent of the Hill States and the Deputy Commissioner of Shimla, saying that please call a conference of all the representative chiefs of these territories, elected delegates of the public from each state and British territory like Kot Kai, Kot Garh, Bharoli, Els, etc., representatives of government, and the Tehsildar of Shimla and Kot Kai, representatives of our Himalaya Vidya Prabandhani Sabha, and representatives of the Hindu Sabha of Shimla, which was basically a branch of the Hindu Mahasabha. And he says that there we should come up with laws and rules to stop this form of marriage. So then he says, he says, as has been already represented by this Sabha, the custom of wreath prevalent in this part of the country is nothing short of barda faroshi, which the government proposes to wipe out from this holy land. In support of the above, the Sabha contends that wreath is a custom unknown to the civilized world, under which a person purchases a girl either from the husband or other relatives of the girl to make her his wife on payment of a certain amount, which sum varies according to the merits and beauty of the girl. Since the past few years, girls have been bargained upon like cattle and other household commodities for petty sums of rupees ranging from 100 to 2000 per head. This obnoxious custom is daily taking roots in this country. And then he goes on to say, in this connection, the Sabha humbly invites attention to the Hindu law under which separation of dissolution of marriage is permissible only under very special circumstances, which are not present in the cases of wreath. The majority of hillmen being ignorant of the law, of the Hindu law, they do not realize what extent they have already suffered and are suffering under the baneful influences of this evil. So much so that the tie of marriage has lost its religious sanctity. And then he goes on to say that the Sabha therefore trusts, as in the past, the British government has been pioneers in the emancipation of the people in the, of the obnoxious customs such as female infanticide, sati and thagi. And they will on this occasion take a much needed step with a view to eradicating this evil of wreath from the hills by legislation. Of course, the British don't immediately do anything. They ask for reports from all the hill states, from Kodgai, Kodgar, and other places. And then in January 1925, the superintendent of the hill states writes to the secretary of the governor in Lahore. He says, it shocks the Hindu sentiment because of the element of divorce it contains. Consequently, the alternative proposed is that marriage should be indissoluble during the husband's lifetime. And then he goes on to say, I'm not at all convinced that this is any better. Wreath gives the woman a chance of dissolving an unsuitable union into which she has been thrust during her infancy. The alternative gives her none. Child marriage is the root of the trouble in both cases. And then he goes on to write something on that. And he says, legislation, if any, should strike at this, that is child marriage. But the disposal of a girl as chattel is present in both the systems. To fix lifelong bondage on the woman who has been disposed of as a child is the antidote proposed by the Sabha. It is proposed by men. I see no evidence of consultation of women concerned. For 1925, I was quite surprised by the what this official is writing. The legislation proposed aimed at stopping child marriage, at enforcing registration of contract between adults and at state intervention when such contracts are dissolved. I see no justice in substituting orthodox Hindu marriage for wreath by legislative fiat among people who do not want it, nor do I believe the attempt to do this suddenly has any chance of success, as past experience is an indication. And then he goes on to write other things. Let me go on. There's much to be read out, but I don't want to... So, for example, from Baghat state, this is the manager of Baghat state. He says, in these parts of the country, with the exception of the negligible Rajputs and Sansi Brahmins, all the inhabitants of these places have been accustomed to divorce since ancient times. They have no sentiment on this point at all. On the other hand, it would be disastrous if divorce was stopped. I'm afraid I don't think that a girl is disposed of as chattel in both these kinds of marriage prevalent here. The rule is that parents try to find the suitable bride and bridegrooms for their children with the help of their experience. And it's a little smudged here. The abuse has crept in through the negligence of the parents in the performance of their duties and the celebration of marriage at an early age. And he goes on to say, a woman has as much right to extricate herself from an unhappy position of lifelong duration as has the man. And in the absence of any representation on her part, the discussion on this subject is fruitless. It would be unjust to enforce the limitations of Hindu marriage on women here when society is unaccustomed to these laws. What we have got to do is to revolutionize the basic element of the customs prevalent among these people, but to regulate them in such a way as to remove the possibility and prevalence of abuse. What is very interesting is the Himalaya Vidya Prabandhini Sabha organizes a Hindu conference where you have the chief of Kuthar state, Rana Jagjit Singh, Jagjit Chand, you have Thakur Surat Singh, various other people participating, and people who could not participate but sent their good wishes were all top British officials, including the governor of Punjab, and basically talking about how you have to root out this evil custom in the mountains. And he goes on to say, and the president in his presidential address laid stress on the need of every Hindu male or female to learn Hindi. He emphatically condemned the demoralizing custom of Reet. He said that it was necessary to root out diseases which were sapping the health of men and women of the hills and were one of the chief causes of the depletion of the population owing to decrease in the number of births and increase in the number of deaths. He remarked that the Kanets were Rajputs and have been recognized as such by the Kshatriya Upkarni Mahasabha and the Punjab Rajput Prantik Sabha, and they must adopt the customs, manners and ways of the Rajputs and weed out the evil practices which go to degrade them socially and destroy their manhood. The resolutions that were passed in this Hindu Sabha in 1924 include the abolition of Reet, of learning Hindi, of the custom of Reet which prevails in the hills being the root cause of the degraded conditions of the people of the hills, of their poverty and misery and of the depletion of the population, and being contrary to the Shastras, the rulers and chiefs of the hills and the deputy commissioner and the agent of the governor general in whose jurisdiction the evil customs prevails, are requested to put it down by appropriate legislation. The Hindu community would feel grateful for this boon. And the people who were participating and pushing these were Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya, Swami Vishveshwaranand, Sir Ganga Ram, who's got a whole bunch of hospitals and colleges from Lahore to Delhi, Satyanand Stokes, and various Rajas of the hill states. I would quickly move on. So finally, at the end of all of this, at the end of 1925, towards the end of 1925, in September 1925, the superintendent of the hill states, after all the consultations, says, I think the custom is too deep-rooted in the hill states for it to be advisable for government to take any active action on the matter at present. I have received a letter from the General Secretary of the Himalaya Vidya Prabandhini Sabha asking me to call a conference and take charge of this matter. I am not at all sure that for me to take such an action might not be misconstrued, and I think it would probably be better for the Sabha to call a conference and I may attend in my capacity as superintendent. And the governor writes back through his secretary saying that please do not attend this conference, only send a message saying, and this is given as quote, that what has to be said, the government deplores the existence of the practice and would welcome the introduction of any steps which would lead to the to its abandonment. We are talking of REIT, which is bride price and easy divorce. It feels, that is the government feels, however, that so far as the Hill chiefs are concerned, the matter is one of purely internal administration and that the initiative must be left to the chiefs themselves. Government is, however, in consultation with the chiefs with the best means of putting a stop to this evil and will encourage any chief who is prepared to take practical steps which may have that object. So basically, the government washes its hands of that. The Himalaya Vidya Prabandhini Sabha at the end, around, I think this is the date in the thing, is says December 12-25. So it comes up with a pamphlet, which is this, which is newspaper cutting. So they basically, through the 1924-25 period, they carried on an intensive newspaper campaign all over. And I will not read all that is written in the newspapers, but I'll just tell you where all it was published. And I'll give you some of the titles, the headings, which will give you a sense of what was happening. It was the Statesman, the Indian Daily Mail, the Hindustan Times, Delhi, the Little's Weekly, Shimla, the Servant of India, Pune, Hindustan and Advocate of India, Bombay, the Tribune, Lahore, the Bombay Chronicle, Bombay, the Times of India, Bombay, the British House of Commons, the Legislative Assembly, Punjab, Shimla, the Riyasat, Delhi, the Rajput Gazette, Lahore, Griha Lakshmi in Allahabad, and a pamphlet of the Hindu conference. And the Statesman, for example, headlines it, marriage reforms, quaint customs among Shimla Hill tribes. The Indian Daily Mail from Bombay calls it a Himalayan tragedy. The Hindustan Times in Delhi calls it an ugly fossil. Another newspaper calls it the Himalayan tragedy of marriage. The Kangra District Gazetteer is reproduced and in this Little's Weekly. The Servant of India, Pune, calls it scandalous traffic. The Hindustan from Bombay calls it an evil from the hills. It goes on and on. Most interestingly, in June 30th of 1925, in the Commons, Colonel Wedgwood asked whether Lord Birkenhead would inquire whether the system called REIT prevails in the Shimla Hill states, under which girls are sold for immoral purposes outside those states, and if such traffic did exist, whether he would recommend to the political department to end it. And then C.S. Ranga Iyer takes it up in the Legislative Assembly, in the Punjab Legislative Assembly, and also the India Legislative Assembly in August of 1925. It goes on and on. Anyhow, what I would like to say at the end, just to conclude, I would like to say that there were some people in the, not just the British officials, but there is at least one opinion which I found very detailed, which talks about why these reforms should not take place. So it looks at the rules that were framed, and these rules were circulated in September 1926. These rules are framed for the abolition of the custom of REIT and shall be called the rules for the abolition of REIT. They shall come into force from the 1st of Chet 1984, which basically works out to 6th April 1927. So what does it say? It says marriages performed before the above mentioned date shall be considered valid. Marriage performed after 1st Chet Samvat 1984, that is 6th April 1927, which involved pecuniary or other considerations, shall be considered invalid. No married girl shall stay at her father's house for more than a month without the permission of her husband. After the lapse of 1 month, she shall be handed over to her husband or to his representative on any application filed by either. No husband shall be allowed to forcibly drive out his wife from his house. A wife and a husband can apply to a court of law for divorce on the following conditions: impotency, incurable insanity, leprosy, polygamy, loose character of the woman, unnatural habits, conviction of the husband, only the husband, conviction of the husband for criminal assault on his wife. In case either or the two are unable to protect his or her life, the other shall be responsible for his or her protection and maintenance. A woman shall also be liable to be punished under sections 497 and 498 of the Indian Penal Code, provided sufficient proof is available. At the time of marriage, the differences between the respective ages of the pair should not exceed 10 years. The minimum age of the bridegroom and bride shall be 16 and 12 respectively. A widow shall be at liberty to remarry in all circumstances, provided that is the case of her having a minor child. She must appoint a guardian through a court of law. Besides marriage performed according to Vedic rites, marriages celebrated in conformity with the recognized customs and usages of each state shall be considered valid. No marriage which has been viewed with suspicion or in regard to which there is the least doubt that the bride has been sold shall be registered. Marriages considered invalid at present according to custom and religion shall continue as such in future, and whoever infringes on the above rules shall be liable to be punished by 6 months rigorous imprisonment or a fine of ₹100 or both. Now, on these rules, and I'll end by taking 5 minutes of that, on these rules, the Rana of Koti, right, he had the most detailed, it was a 10-page letter he typed out and sent Rana Raghubir Chand, the Rana Sahab of Koti State. Koti, for those who don't know, is basically today Shimla, Sanjoli and the surrounding areas. And he has a long detailed argument saying that basically he says it is wrong. I don't follow it. My family doesn't follow it. But he says this is not something we should interfere in. He goes on to say, he gives a whole range of data to say that other than a very few number of families, everybody, so he says, for example, it is incumbent on me to mention that while the Reeth marriage custom in Koti state is not followed by Rajputs, that is, now note what he talks of Rajputs, my family and connections amounting to say 20 people in number, the custom is followed by all my subjects, including Brahmins. I have mentioned the above facts in order to make it clear that an immense amount of public opinion and feeling would be aroused against me in my subjects were I to attempt peremptorily to abolish the Reeth custom by adopting the suggestions set forth in the draft rules. It is, I think, expedient that I should comment upon the draft rules in some detail. With regard to rule number 4, which says that marriages performed after 6th of April 1927, which involved any bride price, will be illegal. He says, with regard to Rule 4, it must be pointed out that the money which is paid by the intending husband to the parents is in its origin intended to assist poor parents to pay the wedding expenses. By established custom, no intending husband can obtain a daughter in marriage from her parents unless this money or its equivalent has been paid to the parents. The immemorial custom in this as well as in other neighboring states is that if a wife leaves her first husband and goes to live with another man, that second connection is legalized and the issue thereof are legitimate and are recognized heirs of and inherit the property of the second husband, provided the second husband has paid the reap money to the first. If the money has not been paid, the second marriage is irregular and the children do not inherit. To cancel this immemorial rule of inheritance would, as matters now stand in this state, cause very serious discontent and disturbance, for which it goes to the basis, for it goes to the basis of the succession of land, and land to the man of the hills is even more than it is to the Punjabis or the plains. As to rule 5, which is that the wife should not stay with the husband, he says that, so with the father for long, he says that is already there, and he says, at present, only grounds for divorce recognized are desertion by the husband, where the wife is allowed to marry without payment of reeth money, and divorce by payment of reeth money by the wife to leave her former husband. As far as Hindu law is concerned, the law is, of course, followed by myself and my family. There is no such thing permitted as divorce, and it would be against the principles of Hindu law to open, much more to widen, the grounds for divorce as proposed by Hindu, by Rule 7, which says you can divorce under impotency or insanity or leprosy or polygamy or elsewhere. Rather, it would be in accordance with our religion to prohibit divorce altogether. With regardness to the looseness of the marriage tie at the present existing here, it is permissible to compare this with the, then he goes on to other laws and other things, and he says, this we should not change. Finally, he goes on to say that I hesitate to announce a policy that, in the face of opposition of 99% of my subjects, I would be unable to put into effect, and that for its full imposition would almost certainly require me to call on assistance the physical forces of the British government. And then he says he is not going to, unless forced by the British, impose these laws. However, as we know, over the period from the 1930s till the 1980s, over these 50 years, marriage customs more or less in the Western Himalayas changed to a form of marriage as we recognize it today, which is the normal family form, where you have the nuclear family, which is the core of the family. Even if brothers are living together, the nuclear family, the husband, the wife, their children are the core of the family. They are the people who own the property, and property is inherited through that means. Now, this reform happened, this is the initiation of that reform, and in various parts of the Himalayas, this reform happened in different ways. Some places, the reform was very smooth within two generations, as in what is today Himachal. This happened in much of Uttarakhand, it happened. But in parts of Himachal, in parts of Uttarakhand, in much of Nepal till well into the 1980s, in various parts of the Northwest Frontier, in various parts of what are called the northern areas, in various parts of other parts of India, this reform did not happen. And you still had instances of bride price, you had instances of easy divorce, you had instances where brothers were marrying together. In fact, there's a very, very interesting book by Paul Hirschman, who does political anthropology of the Punjab plains. And just like Malcolm Darling had done in the 1920s, he is looking at the 1960s and the 1970s. Paul Hirschman, I've forgotten the name of the book, but it was a PhD, which unfortunately Paul Hirschman died before he could publish the book. So his friends got together and published his PhD as a book. That talks about the existence of exactly bride price, of polyandry, of easy divorce in the areas of the Doaba in the plains of Punjab. So this is a long-term process. And today, when we look at the normalized family in the mountains, we forget this long history of family reform. And often it is seen in terms as if it was something barbaric, something uncivilized, something to be ashamed of. Whereas I think if you look at it historically, if you look at it through a correct perspective of how people were organizing their life, we realize that this was a very stable, long-lasting form of family organization, which sustained itself for, as the British documents say, immemorial times. I'll stop here, partly because I have taken almost 20 minutes more than I had initially planned for, and also my throat is very dry. I need to have some more tea, but I'll be happy to answer questions or react to comments or anything. Sonali, up to you.
Yeah, thank you so much for that wonderful lecture. Really getting to, you know, I had heard some stories from my mother about polyandry in Sirmaur, and she used to tell me, oh, you know, my grandfather used to say that the woman would be riding a horse and she would go and get the groom. And I found that so fascinating. And today you kind of shed light on these marriage alliances and how it was in the past. But one question, as an archaeologist, I do have is, while you were conducting your ethnographies in different parts of the Himalayas, how do you see, you know, the spacing of gender when it comes to vernacular architecture? So you have these Katkuni architectural types, which are very traditional. How, and they're still there, 70 years old, 100 years old, how have they adapted to these changed family forms? Did your research bring about anything, any information on that? Because when you look at the Bakhli, is it called, or Bakhali in Kumaon, you know, those long row of homes, and then
Bakhli,
you have
Bakhli system.
Yeah. Oh. And here in the in Kullu Valley, those Katkuni architectural types, where, you know, there are these narrow at the bottom and wide at the top, and then there's a kitchen area, there's a devtas area. So how have these spaces adapted to the changing family forms? Because as an archaeologist, the first thing I look at is spacing of places and gender roles in within those spaces. So if you could answer that, I would be very grateful.
Yeah, Sonali, actually the thing is, I'm not an archaeologist, and unfortunately historians and archaeologists haven't as much as they should. So when I was looking at it, I wasn't really looking at much at, you know, how the houses are structured and things like that. But hearing your question, I'm just thinking there's certain things which keep coming up. So for example, one of the things that British records talk about is, because see, the British were fascinated. I mean, it was this sort of, want of porn, I suppose, this was like the thing, oh my God, this polyandry, it was almost, I'll get to your question, but let me just quote this from Patricia Oberoi's book, you know, where there is this excellent chapter on Himalayan polyandry by Gerald Berriman. And Patricia Oberoi has this really nice note here. She said, fascination with polyandry is no doubt partly because of its unusual appealing to our exotic bias. However, one cannot overlook the possibility also of an androcentric bias. Most anthropologists have been men and are trained by men. Polyandry has seemed to them puzzling and challenging. While its sexual mirror image, polygyny, is not only seen as common, but also evidently seems more plausible, expectable, even agreeable. Polyandry has elicited innumerable and often tortured attempts at explanation. Whereas polygamy attracts little attention, creates little curiosity, and generates only little literature. So, I mean, I'm also guilty of that. So, you know, I wasn't really looking at these things. But one of the things that the British talk about often is that how are sleeping arrangements organized? So they say, for example, the woman would keep the slippers of the man she wanted to sleep with. Sometimes it would be organized as who has first rights, who has second right, who has third right, who was living on the first floor of the house, who was living on the second floor of the house, who has access, sexual access inside the house, who has sexual access outside the house. So there certain brothers have sexual access only outside the house, in the fields. Some brothers have sexual access inside the house. I really don't know. This is something very interesting to see whether the manner in which house construction, the structure of the village, the structure of the habitation, the structure in which the homestead is organized has changed. I suppose, especially in the last 20 years, everything is giving way to concrete and the 2 BHK format, you know, the sort of soul numbing 2 BHK format everywhere else. But how exactly this was happening?
Shanali, you know what, the question that you have asked is very beautifully described by the Barclay system. And if you look at Aniket's diagram, where there are three brothers and then three wives, that at that level, it translated into, you know, the kind of horizontal homes that spread. So your question is really very good. The vernacular space is related to the way the family was changing from polyandry to polygamous slowly. And Aniket's diagrams clearly reflect that. So when I was in Garhwal, I spoke to how did the emergence of the Barclay system happen. So it happened at that level, at the third level, where he says, the brother may have gone for a trade, or he may have gone out for work or something, and then he comes back and they take the third wife. So there's three and three, and the spreading of the horizontal space, in this case not vertical, happened because of that kind of progression. And it's very interesting. This question is really very good, and some anthropologists should do linkages between family forms, changing cultural spaces, and vernacular architecture. It is a wonderful area of study.
And I think vernacular architecture can really kind of substantiate all the points that how it is adapting, how it's changing, and also within the cultural memory of the people.
The other point I wanted to make here was that, you know, because it is really, really difficult. I mean, I'm not a trained anthropologist. I'm a historian who was doing anthropology, historical anthropology, when I was doing my PhD research and others, and I was looking at historical documents with an anthropological perspective. But, you know, when I went and spoke to people, it is very, very difficult to get people to talk about this. So I'll give you instance. I was told that, by somebody in Shimla, I was told that go to so-and-so village, and the lumberdar of that village, his sons, I mean, the lumberdar is from a previous, when the, you know, hill states used to be there, the British times. His son is still there, and his son might still have some documents, of what I have heard. So the son's son, that is the old British lumberdar's grandson, was similar to me in age, about a few years younger. So I got in touch with him through friends, and I went and said, okay, I'm going to reach at so-and-so time, and I'm going to spend a day with you. And so I was reaching one morning, and I was going to stay the whole day and the night and leave the next afternoon. And I reached there, and then he sort of meets me. And of course, I'm the only one wearing very different dresses and with a backpack and, you know, a bottle of water. So of course, I'm identifiable. And I say, okay, let's go and meet your father. And he says, haha, pehle thoda chai pi lete hain. So we have tea. And then he says, yahan ke local health department ke yahan bahut achhe doctor hain, unse miliye. So then we go and meet the doctor. Then he said, yahan bahut achhe. And I'm saying, no, I need to meet your father. I need to look at these things. I just have a day. I might come back. And he says, haha, karenge, karenge. After about 6 hours of doing this, finally he says, kaun se pitaji? कौन से पिताजी से मिलना है एंड ऑफ कोर्स आई वाज स्टंप्ड बिकॉज़ आई हैडन बीन टोल्ड कौन से पिताजी आई मीन यू नो यू नॉर्मलाइज दिस दैट ऑफ कोर्स यू हैव टू गो एंड मीट द फादर एंड नाउ यू हैव टू चूज व्हिच फादर सो आई सेड आई डोंट नो व्हिच फादर ही सेज ऐसा है एक पिताजी तो अलग हो गए डिविजन कर लिया वो तो इलेक्ट्रिसिटी बोर्ड में काम करते हैं और दूसरे पिताजी ऊपर यहाँ फर्टिलाइजर और बीज की दुकान है वहां बैठते हैं और एक पिताजी नीचे गांव में है तो मैंने कहा वो जो इलेक्ट्रिसिटी बोर्ड के उनसे तो नहीं मिल सकते बट बाकी जो है उनसे मिल लेंगे तो आई मेट बोथ द फादर्स एंड ऑफ कोर्स ही डिडंट फाइंड द डॉक्यूमेंट बट वी फाउंड वेरियस अदर थिंग्स what we call polyandry or group marriage, the Himalayan family, they will not mention this. To outsiders, by the 1980s, it was there. So I think it's a great thing, in fact, to look at built architecture, to look at material remains, to, you know, not think of archaeology as something really ancient, but something living with people, and people living through that, to try and understand how family life was structured. Yeah.
Yeah, my power just went off, so I kind of missed the last part of what you just said.
Sonali, just saying that, you know, this is something where, because it is so difficult to get people to talk about it, and it was so difficult in the 90s itself, today it is far more. There is an active process of forgetting, of unlearning these family forms. So it becomes so much more interesting to look at built structures, you know, architecture, material remains, and not as in ancient forms, but, you know, lived structures and lived remains, to try and understand how people organize their life. Because there is this incessant pushing that what was there earlier was somehow barbaric, uncivilized, immoral, terrible, un-Hindu, etc., etc. So people are really wary of talking about that.
Yeah, so even if ethnography is not a possible, but I do think that just looking at their architecture and how, looking at the age of the architectural space that they have been living and how their families have kind of expanded, that it could be a good analysis to substantiate all these things that are happening in these times with the changing laws and everything, and how the family is adapting in space, and how does that further impact gender relations as well, physically speaking, you know, in that material kind of setup. So I really liked your analogy of how you were explaining that how in the 1910s, how in the 1920s, 30s, 40s, and how an observer would just think, oh, it's polygamy, when it was actually not polygamy. It was, I really liked that study of yours. So it's so, so interesting. And and I'm sorry I missed a bit of it because the power went off in the Western Himalayas. I don't know what's happening with the power these days. But we have a Dr. Nandini Bhattacharya who has a question. And all of those who have questions, please raise your hand. So you have a tab on the screen where you can raise your hands and I'll take your questions accordingly. So Dr. Bhattacharya, you can take over the mic, please.
Yeah, can you hear me? You can hear me?
Yes, we can.
Yeah. So thank you, Dr. Alam, for the rich narrative of the long passage from pre-colonial customs via colonial cultural legal hegemony to the emergence of the modern structure of the society in the Western Himalayas. So I have certain questions. Actually, it is quite directly connected to my first work, which I worked on Hindu law, the invention of Hindu law. What are the Dharma Shastras and Shastras were not Hindu law? The colonial invented Hindu law on the basis of selective appropriation of the Dharma Shastras. And they wanted to introduce uniformity or to all over India on the population who were not Muslims, who were not Christians. So in the process, lot of tribes were drawn within the orbit of Hindu law. So what I can see in your presentation, that this particular community is drawn within the orbit of Hindu law. They had a different custom. They had a different, like, polyandry. And polyandry was there in each part of the world. And Draupadi and Mahabharata celebrated polyandry. And I sort of kind of want to comment on certain terms you used like barbarian. The British used the term barbarian for each tribal communities to extend their hegemony, to extend their domination. And British were concerned with two things. One is land. Land means revenue. And secondly, they were concerned about culture. Culture was the civilizational binary. That is the superior Occident vis-a-vis the inferior Orient. And the inferior Orient was represented by women. So here, while they were talking about the abolition of polyandry, they were talking about the lack of chastity. I mean, this kind of lack of chastity in a structure of polyandry was not there. But they kind of imposed the term. And finally, they drew the tribal societies within, you use the term normalcy, quote unquote, normal. Normal for the colonial period, normal for the colonial imagination, normal for the colonial revenue collection system. I can speak more, but I shouldn't. I really want your reaction on this.
Yeah, thank you for this. In fact, I agree with you entirely that, you know, Hindu law as we understand it was called ancient and something which came down from the hoary past, but it was actually an invention, a very sort of deliberate, it was not even an invention at a sort of lapse of attention. It was a very deliberate invention of the 19th century colonial period and continued in the 20th century. But be that as it may, the people, the actors involved were viewing themselves, both the British as well as the Indians who were part of this enterprise, were viewing themselves as setting a historical wrong right, that getting the original, the authentic Hindu back in place, the authentic, recreating the authentic Hindu community, the authentic Hindu practices. And in that project, the reform of Himalayan families, the Himalayan marriage practices, sort of aligned itself with that, tried to align itself with that. Initially, not very successfully, with a lot of skepticism from both British officials and some of the local rulers and others, but eventually, as we see, very successfully. The use of the word barbarian that I use is not my own. I'm not calling them barbarians. And even when typically I do call them barbarians, I call them in the way, say, somebody like James Scott does, as a wonderful thing. I mean, when you compare it with civilized people who live under states, barbarian is a great thing, but I wasn't using it here in that sense either. I was using it to paraphrase what I found in the archives in both the British writings as well as the writings of Himalayan young men who were campaigning for the reform. So they were considering this to be a barbarian custom. And of course, the norm that was being set was the norm of Hindu law, that is what is the norm. And as Hindus, as Rajputs, it is very important. In fact, there is this wonderful, there is this wonderful small letter by the Raja of Rampur, Bushehr, who, he doesn't spend too much of time writing long letters. I mean, he's the biggest Raja. He says, I have seen your thing and I have not much to say. He says, if you want these rules framed, it will not cause any turmoil and I will sort of impose them, and goes on. And he says, since a few years, there are no Kanits in my state, as all have been made Rajputs. So 1924, he's saying a few years ago, all the Khanates of Rampur Bushehr have been classified as Rajput. So this was the same process where people were recreating. Well, you could, as you do, following Hobsbawm's inventing traditions, you do talk about inventing of that law, inventing of identities, inventing of a new family form, which wasn't there, but was now considered the norm. So that is what I'm talking about, that there was this whole attempt by the Himalaya Vidya Prabandhini Sabha, by the Hindu Mahasabha, by the various state rulers to create a normal Himalayan family, the family which is now going to be the norm. It is not abnormal. It is not barbarian. So that would be my response. There are
Yes, now it is abnormal in our perception because we are Western educated. But we can use the term modern. Can we use the term normal? Do you label all those pre-colonial people who had their own structure of society as abnormal? I have objection to that. And I do understand that you are not using the term Burmesian on your own. You are kind of reproducing the colonial term. But I do, when I write about the tribe, I do it within a quote.
So use of barbarian was, in a sense, among quotes, I didn't sort of do scare quotes. Yeah, it was. But, you know, about the normal, I would still take issue with that. I mean, the thing was that the attempt of the people was to become the norm, to reform themselves. And initially, it was something which was done by a few reformers from outside. But it was adopted by people. And if you go to Himalayas now, whether it is Himachal Pradesh or Uttarakhand or Jammu or other parts, much of Nepal now for that matter, you would find that people have actively worked towards becoming the norm. And if you tell them that, no, this is not how you were, they would be furious with you. So what I'm recounting is actually the history of how people adopted to the norm as they understood the norm. The norm, as we realize, was itself in active invention during the colonial period.
And I would like to add, you know, Dr. Bhattacharya, you know, with the as anthropologists, like when you study Etic and Emic perspectives, even the British perspective is their perspective, and the word terminology they're using, it speaks something about how they envision the world and how, you know, the locals envision the world and how we are envisioning their world. And I think that's what Dr. Aniket is showing here.
Actually, the British, this is my first book, Appropriation and Invention of Tradition, the East India Company and Hindu Law in Early Colonial Bengal. So in that book, it was my Oxford dissertation that is published from OUP. Now it is out of print. There I show that Dharmashastras were not law. It had juridical components, but it were not law. Colonial, the British administrators, they compiled two codes and in Sanskrit they translated and they tried to extend it as far as to the tribal world. They couldn't do it in the northeast, but in the northern and western Himalayas, they abolished all the local customs and they imposed Hindu law on them. That's what I mean, actually. Anyway.
Okay,
there is a question in the chat. Can I take that, Ali? There's a question from Swati Kondroli. Hi, Swati. So she's asking, I think everybody can see that.
Yeah,
so
I don't. Ask the question. Yeah. So if she can take over the mic, she can ask that question. She's a political science student in University of Punjab. And she's working on Tibetan reform in Dharamshala. That's right, Swati, right?
I think But yeah. Chat, so I don't think that needs to be repeated. I can just respond to that or what?
I think some of the audience do not
read. Okay, sure. Yeah, I understand.
Ask your question, please.
Hi. Am I audible?
Yeah, absolutely.
Hi, Dr. Aniket. Firstly, it was really a very engrossing talk. I really enjoyed it. I just wanted to ask, throughout your talk, there was this realization that, how we didn't really use the term Pahari culture or Pahari identity. I just wanted to know how do you perceive it in the present context, and how do we relate the, reform of the family forms with the change in the Pahari identity, and what do you think about the so-called normalization and civilization of mountainous people? How has it led to the erosion of authentic Pahari culture, if there was, And especially, I would like you to comment on, the Pahari culture in the states like Himachal Pradesh and Uttarakhand.
So, the thing is, the identity Pahari itself is, to use the phrase from the earlier engagement interaction, it is an invented thing. And what I speak about, the reform of the family, was actually one of the crucial things that went into providing a stable cultural, social, emotional foundation for this new Pahari identity. So the older family forms, the older social forms, the older social identities like Kane, Khash, these slowly moved out. And now you have new identities, which are Rajput and Brahmin, and they align themselves well with the national other, like pan-Indian identities, the Hindu identity. And then, so there is a whole parallel thing also going on, for example, through the 19th century of the educated young people from the mountains insisting and working on the fact that they are as much Hindus, even if they don't follow whether the practices of caste or the practices of family or, various other things which identify in the Hindu laws as they were being invented under colonialism as Hindu. So they were not being identified as Hindu, but they were saying, we are Hindu, so we are going to reform ourselves. We are going to change the way we hold land. We are going to change the way we identify ourselves socially. We are going to change our family. We are going to change our language. So Hindi becomes very important. So if you see, for example, in this, in the 19, this period, it's either English, or you would see in between, there is Mustalik script.
Okay.
And the Hindu Sabha says constantly, the Hindu Sabha is saying that, where does it go? That every male or female in the mountains should learn Hindi in the Nagari script. Another necessity of the hills was to spread Hindi education written in Nagari characters. This is essential. So from the 1920s, that is not there. They're saying we have to do it. So all of this then creates, they then go on and say that this is what creates Dev Bhumi. So let me just quote this. Another great necessity of the hills, this is after saying that abolish Reet, says another great necessity of the hills was the spread of Hindi language written in Nagari characters. Further, the establishment of a college at Shimla is a great necessity for the promotion of higher education. If enlightenment was to be widespread among the masses, it was necessary to impart elementary education to them in Hindi written in Nagari characters. Another great necessity was the abolition of the custom of reet. Then he says, in conclusion, I request my brother chiefs and all the members of the Hindu Sabha to encourage education among our subjects here to better our economic conditions and to raise ourselves in the scale of civilization. So I sort of underline this, raise ourselves in the scale of civilization, because that is the thing, you see, and that is what creates this Pahari identity. And one of the very interesting things is that if you look at 1980s, if you look at the newspapers, if you look at political texts and others, academic writing that is happening, you will realize that much of this is, there is no Himachali identity. The Pahari is an amorphous identity. But today, if you look at it, there is a very strong Himachali identity coming up. In fact, somebody who has done his post-graduation and at Punjab University, Swati, whom you may know, Aman Kant Panta, he's actually looking at that thing. And it's very, very interesting. How does Himachali identity as a new sub-national identity emerge? What is it? Is the Pahari identity throughout the hills, or is it something only Himachali? So it's a fascinating thing. But family reform was crucial. Without this family reform, you cannot have a normalized Pahari identity.
All right. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you. Do you have any other question? I know that Dr. Molly Kaushal had her hand raised a little while ago, if she's still around. Maybe could ask that question.
I did raise my hand at that point, but then I thought that the discussion had taken a different turn. So there was no point coming back and talking about it. But what I was saying about the Bright Prize and the polyandry, but even within Himachal, you have that Bright Prize is there, but the polyandry is not there. And so there are very different kind of ways in which the marriages are contracted. And as you said that the polyandry did provide a space for empowerment, so did many other forms of marriage systems which were within very much a patrilineal, patrilocal family structures have traditionally provided very interesting spaces of negotiation, particularly to the widows and those who are at the borders of the family structures, the women who stand at the borders of the family structure. But then, you know, the whole conversation went on to, and I completely agree that, you know, what is Pahari identity? It is after a construct, and then you go within these communities. So a Gaddi is very much separate from a Kinnauri, and a Kinnauri Pahari, for example, is not what Gaddi Pahari is. And this whole Himachali identity is a much later creation and very, very interesting phenomena, because now you also have the migrants, actually how the migrant population, those who migrated from the Pahars to plains, have actually been pushing a lot for the so-called perceived Himachali identity. And still within them, there is still a lot of tussle and, you know, so who gets kept out of that Himachali identity, or who gets incorporated. So you have these various Himachali organizations, you know, in places like Delhi, Jalandhar, Punjab especially. And there's a whole lot of politics that happens. So even in Himachal, they have those who are on the periphery and those who are at the center of the Himachali identity.
Absolutely, absolutely. In fact, you know, that's essential, because say, for example, the Gaddi is a Himachali, but a Gujar, is a Gujar a Himachali or not? And it's Himachali identity, the Pahari identity. So for example, the whole, that horrendous child rape and murder that happened in Jammu, Katra, was with the Bakarwals, and this whole, you know, conflict between the of a certain community and the settled people of others. Even on marriage laws, for example, in what are considered tribal areas in Himachal now, which is again a completely invented identity. It's completely, you know, it's a legal invention of the last 50 years in a sense. Even in the tribal areas of Lahul Spiti, Kinnaur, I think Sirmaur district is parts of at least Sirmaur district.
Well, are, themselves. Gaddi
becoming tribal. Yeah, in those all those areas, there is this whole tussle over family laws, about what laws you can reform and what laws you cannot reform, and whether this can work. The only thing I would like to react to is that you say that in Himachal there was no polyandry. Actually, the thing is,
no. I didn't say there was no polyandry. What I said that their bride price was there, even though the polyandry, certain communities did not practice polyandry, but the bride price was necessarily there. And because of this, they could still negotiate spaces for themselves, though their women could negotiate these spaces, though it was not a polyandrous relationship, because women had lot of empowerment that they could negotiate within the polyandrous system.
Yeah.
And the other counterparts could also do so.
Right. The only thing is that, it's a little difficult now to think back and say which community had polyandry, which didn't, because these reportings are often sort of mediated by notions of honor and shame and, historical memory, which is being constantly recreated, and what is normal and what is legal and what is Hindu and what is not Hindu, etc., etc. But my sense is that, and I would go here with the 1881 census or Rose's Glossary of Tribes and Castes, or even Emerson writing that group marriage, right, where chastity is not important and sexual exclusivity is not important, is common throughout.
Chastity is not a word that the communities themselves would use.
We have problems with
these categories, and we use them because we don't. But the moment you bring in term like chastity, it becomes problematic. It becomes problematic because the whole discourse that brings it in, and the fact that we don't, even if we don't acknowledge it, we kind of repeat it, and the whole framework then within which we begin to talk about communities somehow gets disbalanced, So that's my point. And you're right, because there's a lot of double descent. So where is the double descent coming from within certain communities? So was there a matrilineage there before? So we don't have very, very ancient records of these communities, it becomes very difficult to say that were they polyandrous earlier or were they not. But what my emphasis was that even while given what we know about them historically, whatever documentation is available, that women had spaces of empowerment within this patriarchal and patrilocal, especially because land, as you yourself, you've hit the nail on the head by saying that it's the land, so land was such, so negotiation of land, retention of the land within the family was so very important that it evolved certain traditions and customary laws according to which that women could actually create spaces for empowering herself within those structures.
Absolutely. Yes.
Thank you, Dr. Morley. And if we have any more questions, can we have the hands raised? If not, please let me know. We do not have any hands raised. I do have an announcement to make. So on the 26th, we will be having a talk on the unseen trap, fish and fishing practices in the Ganga by Abhay Mishra. So please join us next Sunday, same time. And Dr. Alam, if you have some last few words that you would like to tell your audience.
No. There are no. See, the thing is, this is, this is part of, my PhD research was on the Western Himalayas. So I start from there, and this talk is confined to that. But as I indicated a little bit during my talk, I have a project which I call the Forgotten Families. And I think the sort of basic assumption is that what we call the normal family, the monogamous family in India today, which is, say, for example, canonified in the Special Marriages Act and the Hindu Marriage Act and the various other things, where, you know, bigamy is defined and every other thing is defined and, you know, whom you can marry, whom you can't marry, etc., etc. All these things are there. My thing is that these have displaced, replaced a majority of families, different myriad forms of families that existed in the territory of British India, say in 1900. So in a century between 1900 and 1999, you have this whole displacement of all of those by one normative family. And this is part of my larger thing, which I want to do over the next few years, to look at forgotten families and retrieve some of our understandings and learnings from that. So thank you for providing me this opportunity to sort of bring forth a lot of these things which have been lying all scattered all over the place. Some of these things I hadn't looked at in 20 years. So yeah, since I had submitted my PhD. So yeah, it's good to have done this. And thank you so much.
And I
it was a wonderful talk. Yeah, wonderful talk. We really enjoyed.
Thank you. Thank you.
Very, very informative. Also, very thought provoking as well. Yeah.
So, Doctor,
thank you.
Sorry, I keep interrupting. I was wondering that are you also looking into certain rituals here? You know, especially in the Western Himalayas, like we have rituals of the Kahika festival, where the marriage. Of the Nar and the Nora is very important, and how they play into this whole thing, and how these kind of rituals were ritualistic marriage, and how was that understood by the political regime at that time, and how that has adapted. Are you looking into those things as well?
Yeah, well, actually now I'm not looking so much at the Western Himalayas anymore. What I'm trying to do is to look at secondary literature from Rajasthan, from the central provinces, from UP. So for example, there is a famine report from 1999 in the United Provinces, where the famine report talks about the fact that other than the Brahmins, Rajputs and Vaishyas and Kayas, everybody else marries with bride price. And it's very difficult to identify families because women are constantly moving from one family to the other. This is 1899, right? Family report from 1899 from the United Provinces. You see similar things in the central provinces. You see similar things in the Deccan. You see the similar things among the Toda family law. You see similar things in Kerala. You see similar things among the states in Orissa. So I think there's a huge number of different families happening, and I'm looking more at secondary literature, trying to see family studies, trying to see land studies, trying to see, can we retrieve a history of forgotten families in India, which unfortunately most Indians of our generation and those who are younger to us are actively forgetting. We want to forget that. We don't want to remember that. We just want to remember that everybody lived in these happy monogamous Hindu personal law post 1955 sort of families. So yeah, that is what I'm looking at now. So it's mostly going to secondary literature, which is again a new learning for me, because as a historian, I'm trained to look at primary sources.
And it's very interesting to see that it seems that the Western Himalayas, they were more liberal than we think.
Of course. In fact, it would be great if somebody comes up in the Western Himalayas and says, we were, you know, ahead of the times by 100 years. What we were doing 100 years ago with a few changes here and there is what is aspired to by family law today, right? Mm-hmm. Giving rights to women, giving, you know, different types of families, giving openness, etc., etc.
Yes, yes. Thank you so much for this fascinating study and sharing it with all of us. You know, it's really, it was so nice listening to you, and we really look forward to your work and your conclusions after you're finished with this new project. And thank you so much for joining us. And we really
thank you so much.
We want you to come back again when you're ready again. Yeah.
Hopefully when the pandemic is over, I want to visit you guys in Kullu. That will be nice.
Yeah, that will be wonderful. And thank you all for, I know that your team members are here. Ayushi is here, who's a lawyer, and from Italy is here, right?
Yes, yes.
If we could see their faces, that would be wonderful.
I don't know. Yeah, where's Ayushi? Where's Kesang? I saw some of their names, but I can see Ayushi there. And
Yeah. So there's Ayushi. Hello, Ayushi.
And
how are you?
Good. So finally we get to hear all that you all have been doing. It's wonderful.
Yes. And Dr. Gupta, I think I'll be coming your way tomorrow sometime.
Tomorrow?
If that's all right.
I'll be home then. Lovely. Okay. So all of you have a great evening. Stay safe wherever you are. Especially Kesang, she's in Italy, right?
Kesang is here.
Yeah.
I don't know. There's some issue with my camera. I have to look into the settings. But Aniket, it was a wonderful talk. Made lots of notes. And Sonali, thank you so much for organizing this wonderful talk. And we look forward to visiting your institute in Katrai. Been meaning to do that for a very long time. So hopefully once this madness is over.
Sometimes the flood happens, sometimes corona happens. But we will fight it all. So thank you, all of you. And see you next week on Sunday. And I'll post the...
Thank you, Sonali, for this.
I haven't posted the YouTube video from last week. I've been a little lazy, but I'll do both of them together. So sorry for the delay. And see you all soon.
See you.
Thank you so much.
Bye.
Bye.